Hi, and welcome to Lecture 3, which is titled Required Spaces for Cabling. Here, we take a closer look at the standards-based terminology and recommendations for structured cabling infrastructure spaces within commercial buildings, including rooms, enclosures, work areas, racks, and cabinets. Before looking at each space in detail, let's start with an overview of the terminology used to identify the individual telecommunications spaces within commercial buildings. Here's a schematic side view of a multi-story building, with the various spaces identified using initials. Starting at the bottom left, cables entering the building from the outside world are managed in an enclosed ER or entrance room. Alternatively, this location could be a partially or totally open ES or entrance space. From there, we move into the DR or distributor room space serving the entire building, which connects the building's backbone cables to individual DR spaces on every floor. On some or all floors, we may also optionally use smaller DE or distributor enclosure spaces in addition to the floor DRs for additional flexibility. This also applies to CP or consolidation point spaces. Horizontal cables from the DR, DE, and CP spaces extend to equipment outlets or multi-user telecommunications outlet assemblies, which may be anywhere in a modern intelligent building, including within traditional enclosed office WA or work area spaces, outlined here using dotted lines. We'll now look at each of these spaces individually and list the recommendations that should be considered by the cabling infrastructure designer, starting with the entrance room or space. Although it is allowable to use an open space instead of an enclosed room for the entrance of telecommunications cables into a building, a room is preferred for any building with 2,000 square meters or more of usable space. Note that in this context, usable means normally occupied by the work areas and shared spaces of tenants, which exclude spaces that are used for building services, such as electrical or mechanical rooms. It's also possible to eliminate the need for an entrance room or space by terminating the incoming cables in the building's distributor room. In such cases, the distance from the incoming cable's entry point in the wall or floor of the building to its termination point in the distributor room should be as short as possible. This will save space and lower costs, but the designer cannot exceed any length limits on incoming entrance cables imposed by applicable building or electrical codes in the jurisdiction. In addition to cables providing telecommunication circuits to the building, any cables linking this building to one or more other buildings on a shared campus will also be terminated at this location. A term used here is demarcation point, or DMARC, which indicates the exact spot where responsibility for the incoming telecommunications circuits passes from the circuit provider to the building owner. If there's a problem anywhere in the building with a circuit, the provider will test in the outward direction at the DMARC. A successful test result will indicate that the problem is on the building owner's side and not the provider's responsibility. The entrance room or entrance space also includes the mandatory electrical protection of all conductors, necessary to prevent the entry into the building of any hazardous voltages and currents through the incoming cables. This minimizes the risk of personal harm, fire, or damage to electronic equipment within a building from such things as a lightning strike near the path of an outdoor telecommunications cable containing conductive elements, such as the conductors in a copper cable or metal armoring in an optical fiber cable. And if the incoming cable is not fire-rated for indoor use, a transition to fire-rated cable can be made in the entrance room or entrance space using splices or connectors. Next, we move to the distributor room containing the building distributor, sometimes referred to as the main cross-connect or main distribution frame. This room contains network equipment and backbone cabling connections serving the entire building. The distributor room is sized according to the type of distributor it contains. If we're in the main building on a campus, for example, a distributor C would be required, with the room sized at 12 square meters to serve a total of no more than 50,000 square meters. A larger area served would require a larger room. If we're in a standalone building or in one of the satellite buildings that is connected to the main building on a campus, a distributor B would be required, with the room sized at 10 square meters. The clear height to the ceiling should be a minimum of 3 meters, to allow for the unobstructed routing of ceiling pathways such as cable trays. And in order to make it easier to bring in and take out network equipment, the door should not be any smaller than the value shown here. Equipment failure due to environmental factors such as excessively high or low room temperature can be avoided by making sure there's continuous heating, ventilation, and air conditioning or HVAC service in the room, even in cases of a general power outage. Next, we have the distributor room containing the floor distributor, sometimes referred to as the horizontal cross-connect. This room contains network equipment and horizontal cabling connections serving a single floor in the building. The minimum size of the space housing a floor distributor is calculated using the maximum number of equipment outlets expected to be served on that floor. The breakdown is as listed here. Unlike the office spaces in a commercial building, the ceilings in distributor rooms should be easily accessible, not covered for aesthetic purposes with additions like ceiling tiles. Unobstructed ceiling access in all distributor rooms facilitates future cable management, such as the addition of equipment outlets or the upgrade of cabling links. And here are some TIA guidelines intended to provide additional flexibility in the room to plug in devices, both permanently, such as new network equipment, and temporarily, such as battery chargers for tools or test instruments brought in by technicians. Next, we have the distributor enclosure, which can be used to provide services to one segment of a floor, also referred to as a zone. As wireless networking gained popularity in offices, distributor enclosures were introduced to house the wireless access points and other powered network equipment on a floor without taking up usable floor space, which would be the case if additional distributor rooms had to be built. One or multiple distributor enclosures can be added to a floor, either in the initial design or as a retrofit. A distributor enclosure can be a floor-standing unit, it can be mounted on a wall, or it can be integrated into suspended ceiling tiles. It must be emphasized that in all cases, distributor enclosures coexist with the distributor room for the floor. They never replace the room. And as shown here, backbone cable from the building distributor can be routed through the floor's distributor room and terminated in an enclosure, making distributor enclosures scaled-down versions of a distributor room from a design perspective. Other requirements for the enclosure include its placement in the serving area. Central is best for uniform coverage for wireless access points equipped with omnidirectional antennas. If it's placed in an easily accessible location, the distributor enclosure should be firmly mounted and locked. And it should be possible to provide power to enclosure devices that do not have power over Ethernet or PoE functionality. Next, we have the consolidation point space, which serves as an additional connection point for horizontal cabling. The consolidation point houses a passive or non-powered connector that essentially serves as a splice in the horizontal cable. It allows for the partial rather than end-to-end replacement of the cabling run in cases where only a segment of the cable needs to be replaced. Examples include relocating an individual equipment outlet in an office that is being renovated, and the rearrangement of multiple open office work area partitions. Note that a consolidation point can also be retrofitted into an existing installation, which can save money by lowering the total length of cable and amount of labor required for the planned work area changes. Like the distributor enclosure, the consolidation point can be placed in a variety of locations on the floor. Note that ceiling installations may require the use of products with a plenum rating if the proposed location is classified as an air handling space by the authority having jurisdiction, or AHJ. Next, we have work areas, which are open or enclosed spaces allocated to individual users. Here are the recommendations for work areas, with 10 square meters allocated per work area for planning purposes, since each tenant space in a multi-tenant office building will likely have a different density. The design for each work area should have at least one equipment outlet, with two outlets recommended for enclosed offices to facilitate the arrangement of desks, workstations, and devices such as desktop computers and phones. And there should be coordinated placement of equipment outlets and electrical power outlets to make both equally accessible to nearby devices. This concludes the review of telecommunications spaces within commercial buildings. Next, we look at spaces in the form of racks and cabinets, which are commonly located in distributor rooms. Racks and cabinets can be described as movable telecommunications spaces, since they house both network equipment and cable terminations. Equipment racks are basic units consisting of two or four posts. Since all sides are open, there's no way of controlling airflow through a rack. An equipment cabinet can be described as a four-post rack with panels added to all six sides. The panels provide physical protection to the contents, as well as the ability to direct airflow into and out of the cabinet. They can be solid or perforated, with various openings to facilitate cable entry. The BIC-002 standard for data centers recommends a maximum rack or cabinet height of 2.4 meters. For maximum flexibility, a cabinet should be at least 150 millimeters deeper than the largest device it is expected to house. Best design practices suggest allocating sufficient space for a 1200 millimeter depth. It's also recommended to consider cabinet widths greater than 600 millimeters in order to facilitate front-to-rear airflow and cable management. We'll finish off this lecture with a look at temperature and humidity requirements for telecommunications spaces designed to contain powered network devices. The allowable temperature within spaces such as entrance rooms, distributor rooms, and distributor enclosures should be no less than 5 degrees Celsius and no greater than 35 degrees Celsius at all times, preferably with low variation over time. Similarly, the relative humidity in these spaces can range from 8 to 80%. Note that these values can accommodate most network equipment, but there are always exceptions which may require tighter ranges or limits in specific spaces. This brings us to the end of Lecture 3, titled Required Spaces for Cabling. Thank you for watching.